Being the leading fund governance group, DMS has grown substantially over the years and now includes one of the largest AFM UCITS platforms in Europe, which includes distribution, bank, and a risk, regulatory reporting, and full-service FATCA compliance group that services over 800 clients. So to begin, I'd like to take a look at the next generation of credit modeling. There is almost universal consensus that traditional credit scoring metrics for both individuals and businesses are broken and outdated, yet the switching costs remain high. Here today is a person looking to modernize those analog and backward-looking approaches. I've gotten to know David Schreier through his work at MIT Connection Science. I've enjoyed collaborating with him on several white papers and teaching notes around fintech. He is the founder and CEO of Distilled Analytics, and we're thrilled to have him here today to discuss the future of lending. David?
Thank you, John, and thanks to DMS for hosting this discussion today. So we're going to talk today about reinventing credit scoring. This is something we think of as a $10 trillion opportunity. It's an exciting area for me to take a look at as I've spent my career in technology-led disruption, including spending some time building the Enterprise Risk Management and Compliance Group at Dun & Bradstreet together with Vicki Rayburn. So when we look at this and we scope the opportunity, we say, okay, we got to look at two dimensions to the problem. One is the dimension of financial exclusion. There are 2 billion people and 245 million small and medium-sized enterprises globally that are either unbanked or underbanked. It's over $3.7 trillion of fallow capacity. That's headroom for existing lending institutions or new lending institutions to expand into. And some of these things are critically important global problems because, for example, small businesses provide 4 out of 5 new jobs. And right now they're being throttled back by lack of available financial capacity. On the other hand, for the existing book of business, about $6.1 trillion of models misprice risk, and linear regression is to blame. So let's take a look at a few of the problems there. So we've identified 5 key problems with linear regression-based credit scoring. So if you're using any of the 3 bureau-based, you know, FICO-driven scores, or on the small business side, anything involving Dun & Bradstreet, you're reliant on linear regression models. And so we have a new white paper that we'll be coming out with in a few weeks on giving credit, taking credit. And we go into this in more detail. So variability of scoring means that variance in the data used in constructing the scores is not transparent. It's opaque to you as the utilizer of the score. Crack crystal ball means that essentially past performance, it turns out, is not a great predictor of future results. Irrational skew reflects the fact that these kinds of models are not behavioral in nature. So if someone, for example, pays their home bill, their mortgage, they pay their auto bill, and then they don't pay a small utility bill or a credit card bill, that'll have a negative impact on their score, even though it reflects rational prioritization. Asocial analytics refers to the fact that credit scores are fairly dumb about human behavior. And we've done extensive research at MIT in Sandy Pentland's group that shows that peer influence is one of the most powerful forces in governing human behavior. And finally, credit invisibility is where this giant lending gap that I mentioned earlier is reflected. I call it the credit trap. You have to have credit to get credit. So if you have no credit history, you're stuck. And this even can reflect itself in someone who gets a PhD from Oxford and moves to New York City to work at a $500,000 a year analytics job at Goldman Sachs would not be able to get a credit card. In fact, MasterCard and Visa have this problem. When their executives are transferred internationally, they're not able to open new credit card accounts without doing a secured account. So this sort of credit invisibility problem has many ripple effects that ultimately hold back economic progress and retard profits for lenders. So a lot of people have noticed this problem. We're hardly the first to identify it. However, a lot of the approaches that people are taking, although well-intentioned, frequently are based on flawed science. So I like to say sometimes that, you know, are we just engaged in a giant game of wealth transfer from investors to poor people? And I may be overstating the case, but it is certainly something to reflect upon, that if you're not engaged in rational science behind your models, you may as well just be engaged in philanthropy. The methodologies that a lot of these alt credit companies are using are suspect, and we're seeing it reflected in the spiking default rates in certain portfolios. So, extensive research on this a few years ago, where we were looking at major drivers of human behavior. So we looked at things like where you went to school or what you studied in school. Would that have a reflection on your behavior? We looked at things, and those kinds of assumptions go into models used by groups like SoFi or Upstart. We looked at questions of, you know, social media. You know, could your Facebook friends somehow give us an indicator into your credit? And that would be used by groups like Lendo or Hello Soda. And then we applied this social physics methodology, which looks at a much more sophisticated lens on human behavior. And social physics is more than 215% better at predicting what people are going to do than a social media model, and even more predictive than an academic affiliation model. In fact, academic affiliation, it turns out, is worse than random chance at predicting future behaviors. So let's get into that, because I've just made a very bold claim, and I'd like to back that up now. 20 years ago, a group at MIT got together and helped birth wearable computing. This slide shows you probably what your stereotypical image of the MIT student would look like. So these are a group of students in the MIT Media Lab in Professor Sandy Pentland's group. The second gentleman from the left, the inventor of Google Glass, Thad Starner. He was also the guy who coined the term augmented reality while a student at MIT. And what they were playing around with was an idea that as computers miniaturized, as we started to get things that were smaller and smaller, we could begin to put them on our bodies and use them to understand the world around us. So wearable computing led to this inevitable follow-on science of being able to understand human behavior, because we now had signals on what people were doing that we couldn't previously see. So this is a discipline that Sandy calls social physics. And an interesting side note, a couple hundred years ago, when the natural sciences were getting organized, when astrology was turning into astronomy and alchemy was turning into chemistry, they wanted to call the science of understanding human behavior social physics. But they had neither the math nor the computers to be able to really calculate and predict. So they called it sociology. Well, flash forward, we've now gotten to the point where we are able to predict human behavior at scale. And so what this series of signals from these little wearable devices, and by the way, your mobile phone is the most ubiquitous wearable device out there, these give us insight into what's going on in your mind. And these signals that we get from these little wearable devices are far more predictive than things like surveys. Surveys are tremendously unreliable. But if we see, for example, that you're interested in something, it's going to reflect itself in your activity levels. If we see that others are able to shift your behavior, that indicates that you were paying attention to them, that you're engaged. If we see that, for example, you're in a conversation and someone's got their arms folded while they're talking to you very intensely, you will, if you connect with them emotionally, you will tend to fold your arms. You will mirror their behavior. So that's an indicator of empathy. And likewise, if we see you taking action around something that embeds itself into your habits, that reflects itself in consistency of habits. So where this leads us is eventually into the realm of understanding financial behaviors. So we took a look at 100 million credit card records in Asia, and what we found was that we could distinguish between habits or engagement behaviors and exploration or discovery behaviors. And it turns out that how you move around a city and where you buy things in what patterns is a reflection of your state of mind of how you feel about money. And how you feel about money in turn reflects itself in whether you pay your bills on time, whether you default on a credit card, whether you go over limit. In fact, we can do a lot of different stratification with these kinds of rich data sources on human behavior, which can come from either payments data, credit card transaction data, or mobile phone data. So we can distinguish between high income and low income individuals just by looking at communications patterns. So high income individuals have a high degree of spatial diversity, for example, and low reciprocal trust. So you can think of the extreme metaphor of a bajillion people are trying to get in touch with Bill Gates, but how many phone calls does he return? On the other end of the spectrum, people with low income tend to have much lower spatial diversity, but higher reciprocal trust, likely to call them back. And so, again, if we look at communications patterns, we're able to impute critical credit scoring factors like income or changes in income. Similarly, when we took a look at a real bank in Europe with 400,000 customer accounts, we were able to build a better credit score on several different dimensions of credit. We were able to distinguish between late payment versus over limit versus default by looking at how people moved around a city and what were changes in habit. This was 30 to 49% more predictive than the linear regression-based credit bureau model that the bank itself was using. And so that we spun out into a company called Distilled Analytics. So I'm Dave Schreier. That's a brief introduction to a new lens on credit scoring. And certainly feel free to reach out and get in touch, David at distilledanalytics.com, if you'd like to follow up with any questions.
Thanks, David. That was very, very interesting. My name is Daniel Fors. I'm head of business development in North America for DMS. Prior to joining DMS, I was a regulatory lawyer with Dillon Eustace Law Firm, working primarily with U.S. investment managers structuring funds for the European market. Moving on to the next portion of our webinar, one distinct market development in the last 2 years has been the huge appetite of European institutional investors for direct lending strategies. Over the last 18 months, to our knowledge, 12 U.S. managers have launched direct lending funds for sale to European investors. DMS has been fortunate enough to be involved in 9 of these launches. So joining us now to give their unique insights into this trend are Derek Delaney, who's the Managing Director of the DMS European Business based in Dublin, and Laurent Leclerc, Head of Distribution for DMS based in London. Derek, do you want to take it away?
Yeah, thank you, Dan. So yes, you're correct. We've seen 9 direct lending managers. The reason we've seen that is within the European institutional investors, there's been a shift in focus. So because of concern about ability to meet retirement age funding, the institutional investors in Europe, driven from a base in Germany, have changed their investment focus. So prior to AIFMD, European investors were allowed to invest 5% outside of Europe. So when looking to target alternative strategies, they had a 5% bucket to do so. With AIFMD, there is a European regulated alternative product. And they're allowed to invest up to 25% in alternative. So that means there's an extra 20% allocation that these investors can make into alternative strategies. And the driver to do that is to add more alpha generation to the portfolio. So something we've seen is European institutional investors sub out the low yield bonds, sub out CPOs, sub out MBSs, and look to replace that with the consistent returns inherent in a direct lending strategy. So that's the background as to why this has happened. Now, Daniel talked about 9 managers going to Europe. that doesn't mean much if they're not raising capital. But of those nine that are on our platform, there has been commitments of over 15 billion. And there's a significant percentage of that drawn down. And we have seen that hit with very large tickets as opposed to a significant number of investors. So it is the, it's needed in the portfolios, it's needed for the returns, and your peers have gone and been successful in this market. Now, when doing this, how do you go and set up the fund? So direct lending had previously fallen under shadow banking and was put under that definition in 2010 post the crash. Ireland was the first structure to go and pull direct lending out from under shadow banking and allow the creation of direct lending funds in Europe. When that happened, the first being about 18 months ago, it was done as a fund-to-fund model where the European funds would invest into Cayman or US Delaware conduits. Now it's more common that whether it be Luxembourg or Ireland, there is direct origination in the Irish structure. The reason that has happened is that the German rules have changed, whereby you cannot use a conduit vehicle. So rather than the fund-to-fund model, where the Irish or Luxembourg funds invested into the Cayman, which further invested into the onshore Delaware, it is now directly originated in the Irish. And what that, why that is important is it means that direct lending funds, the construct of direct lending funds has been considered, has been determined that we do want this strategy by the German institutionals, and they have determined the manner they want it. So a European fund directly originating US loans or global loans from Europe is now the prescribed by the German institutional. And what we've always seen is that the German institutional is the precursor to what the other institutionals across Europe will end up doing. So with that background as to where the demand has come from, I'll hand over to Laurent who can talk more specifically to the investor side.
Thank you, Derek. Thank you very much again for giving us some time to talk about direct lending and private debt in Europe. I'm Laurent Leclerc. I'm head of distribution for DMS. I'm based in London, but we've got global exposure to investors all over the world. And I've been privileged to be, I've been exposed to the asset class before anybody called it an asset class back in 2009. So I'm going to share with you some of the trend and weakness I've seen since 2009 in this sector. Of course, it's been mentioned by John and Derek, the big appetite for direct lending and private debt in general in Europe, with investors expecting to increase their allocation in 2017 versus 2016, and an expected asset under management of about $750 billion, which represent about three times the size of this market back in end of 2008. However, as I said, we've witnessed some several shifts or trend I want to share, I would like to share with you. The first one on the manager side, there is a trend that we've seen in other alternative asset class, such as private equity or hedge fund, but are really have accelerated in private debt and direct lending, which is the big fund managers are getting bigger. We've witnessed in the recent some multi-strategy fund manager raising multi-billion in the range of 5 to 7 billion funds, and a myriad of small manager raising smaller fund. But in general, a smaller number of funds, about 115 funds last year, have raised a bigger amount of money. So there is a barbell approach or a concentration with big manager and a myriad of small manager. The second shift on manager is best illustrated by sharing with you some of my personal experience as a speaker to a private debt conference or direct lending conference in Europe, but also in Asia. Back in 2010, I was the chairman of a conference that was called a mezzanine conference back in London. 3 years later, the same conference was called Private Debt and Mezzanine. And in 2016, this conference was called and was moved to Paris to become a direct lending and private debt conference. Just an illustration of the marketing tool that manager has been following, where most of the manager now are offering a direct lending to a strategy to some sort, or a special situation strategy, and we've seen disappearing strategies such as mezzanine as a standalone product. There's the two shifts I wanted to mention on the manager side. As Derek mentioned, I'm in front of investors. I'm talking to investors, so I'm going to share you the two important shifts on the investor side now. As John mentioned, there is a constant search of yield, and this constant search of yield and compression of return on, let's say, the large cap senior loans, corporate lending, has pushed investors into other strategy that a couple of years ago will have been overlooked or will have been covered by, let's say, the hedge fund desk at investor or the fixed income desk. I'm talking about strategies such as CLO, CDOs, any structured debt finance, or what I will call specialty finance like aviation, leasing, or trade finance. So these strategies are aiming for shorter duration, asset-backed, unleveraged double-digit strategy, and they're finding their place in the private or direct lending allocation by investors. The second shift on the investor side has been, yes, of course, majority of the allocation in private debt are coming out of private equity allocation with the consultant and the gatekeeper, where we remain in front of this this gatekeeper, are still promoting this, as I said, as an alternative to private equity. But again, the search for yield has attracted a new type of buyers, a non-private equity buyer to the sector, and they're using it as an alternative to a listed or high yield fixed income allocation. Unfortunately, these new buyers are not always comfortable with an LP GP blind pool 5 years plus 2 and 20 fund structures. Therefore, managers have adopted their offering, and many players now are offering some sort of, as an alternative to fund, some sort of special purpose vehicle or structured finance vehicle or notes to accommodate investment from these bond buyers or deal buyers. And the third shift I wanted to mention is something we've witnessed also in private equity, and the pressure on fees, management fees, turn to facilitate co-investment and private placement syndication. So there's the three shifts I've seen on the investor side. Of course, I'm very happy to discuss any other shift or any other trend we are witness all over the world and specifically in Europe, but more than happy to answer any question by emails or feel free to contact us.
Okay, excellent. Thank you, Laurent. So once we've had those conversations with you, once we've talked to you about distribution, what else can DMS do? So on the on this slide, you'll see that DMS will provide a platform for managers to access Europe. What does that platform mean? So it means that we are the entity that is regulated in Europe. We're the entity answerable to the European regulator, not you. So there is a shift of first responsibility from you to us. That is because the European regulator wants the ultimate responsible party to be in their domicile. We then passport your fund utilizing our AFMD license across Europe. So we've now registered in 34 different countries. That includes countries like Singapore, Taiwan, Hong Kong, not just European countries. We then do the regulatory reporting to all of those. We set up the board meetings, we produce the information, we perform the due diligence on your administrator, your depository, your auditor. We coordinate the financials, review your marketing information, help make sure it's in compliance with applicable registration. So we're your regulatory umbrella, we're your feet on the ground in Europe. The majority of managers go one step further and utilize a DMS platform. The DMS platform means that we also select the administrator, auditor, legal for you. We contract all of those, and you end up with one contracting entity. You end up in a direct manager to DMS, and DMS contracts to everyone else. That platform we've put together, what we've done is worked with a core group of 30 institutional investors, understood their preferred partners, and put them in place. So you're an immediate due diligence tick against DMS and against providers. You want contracting party. And because of the volume of direct lending funds we have on these platforms, we're able to offer you a lower a price, a lower TER than you're able to generate on your own. So that gives the investors the absolute comfort that they're looking for, that everything has been done correctly, the responsible parties in place, that everything's been overseen. Something else we've seen them strongly push for, and this coalesces both the European investor and the US onshore investor, is the push towards independent fund representation. And I'll hand back over to John, who's our expert in that area.
Great, thanks, Derek. Thank you very much. So, as Derek indicated, the rise of direct lending has lent itself to an increased need for a very specialized form of governance in the form of the independent fund representative. So the primary issue is avoiding tax withholding for non-US investors driven by US sourced income. So one popular solution, not the only solution, but a popular solution, the season and sell model, involves holding the loans in a US entity for some period of time and then selling the pro rata exposure to the offshore entity. To pass scrutiny, the transaction needs to be arm's length, and to avoid any self-dealing complications for investment managers from Rule 206, the investment manager should seek some sort of independent representation for the offshore fund. So the directors, advisory boards, and independent fund representatives can get a little confusing, largely because there is a degree of overlap. So I'm not sure if this Venn diagram helps. It was very clear in my mind when I made it. But the point is that directors sit on corporate structures where fiduciary responsibility is embedded into the entity's articles, and with some exceptions, Delaware and Cayman law. A director's authority and function in a corporate directorship role comes from this fiduciary standard and is detailed in the entity's articles of incorporation. Generally, these include things like ensuring the investment manager manages the portfolio in line with the fund's offering docs, oversight of NAV, audited financial statements, and overseeing any contracts or obligations entered into by the fund. While the day-to-day function of this is delegated out back to the investment manager and other third parties, the board ultimately remains responsible. Advisory boards replicate this function to some extent for partnership entities. While the fiduciary standard is not generally embedded in the partnership's organizing principles, a good faith standard usually exists, and the functions in practice tend to mirror that of directors. So the independent fund representative tends to sit at the intersection of all this activity, yet it's usually, not always, but usually focused specifically on the loan sale transactions that fuel the season and sell model. So the key to the IFR's role is independence. The IFR represents the offshore vehicle that is generally purchasing the loan. So while it's clear that the manager's initial intent was to spread exposure pro rata across the domestic and offshore vehicles, for this to work, the IFR has to look at the transaction as separate and distinct from that intent. So key is to evaluate the fairness and appropriateness of this transaction on a standalone basis. The manager would generally supply the IFR the initial criteria for determining appropriateness and suitability. And the IFR needs to examine this in line with the fund's offering documentation to ensure the trade is in line. Even more crucial is ensuring that no meaningful changes have occurred during the seasoning period that change the value proposition to the offshore fund. The IFR isn't there to ensure the offshore fund takes its share of risk. If the market or if market or trade conditions have changed, for example, increased default risk in an asset underlying the loan, the IFR is responsible for ensuring the fund he or she represents is paying fair value. So this can result in some potentially awkward conversations, and if we're being intellectually consistent, it could theoretically result in a manager charging more for the offshore vehicle if interim changes have improved. Now, this is all fairly rare. The period is usually not that long that any significant change is going to occur. But these pricing and risk considerations should be looked at each time, and equally important is that process, that interaction of data transfer and investigation should be codified if there ever was any scrutiny on the model. So that is, we've reached the end of our webinar. I'd like to thank all of our participants, especially David Schreier from MIT Connection Science and Distilled Analytics for joining us. If you have any follow-on questions or would like to learn more about Distilled Analytics, you can reach out to any of the DMS people identified here, Derek, Laurent, Daniel Forbes, or myself. The contact information was shown in the webinar, and we will follow up with that shortly. Thank you, everyone, for attending, and have a wonderful day.